Hello children, so here we are back with video 2 and part 1 of geography chapter India size and location. So today I'm going to explain it to you, the last two topics. Okay, so be ready with it.
Okay.
In this video we are going to cover the following topics. As usual, we are going to start with the textual reading. There are some important things that there are there in the textbook, so I'll share with you, especially the Do You Know section. Then we'll discuss about India as a subcontinent, why, which other countries are there, and very little intro about the SAARC organization. Now, India and the world, that is your topic. Okay, so it's given here, India and the world, and this is the next topic that we are going to take here, India's neighbors. Okay, these two topics we are remaining with. So under this, India and the world, I'll be taking all these things into consideration. Contacts with the world, will discuss some important passes of the ancient passes. They are not given there, but it can come in the exam. I'll discuss some questions on in the last paragraph of textbook on page number 4. Then I'll show you a flowchart of India's neighbors and the boundaries that are shared with these neighbors. And then we will discuss Gulf, Bay and Strait, how are they different from each other, and I'll show you through a map also. Okay, and there are some important points regarding Andaman and Lakshadweep Island. We'll just go through it because you have done this earlier also in your physical division chapter, so nothing new. So first thing first, we will take up the textual reading of the two paragraphs, so that in case anybody is not having the textbook, that child should not suffer. Now, India and the world. The Indian landmass has a central location between the East and the West Asia. India is a southward extension of the Asian continent. The trans-Indian ocean routes, which connect the countries of Europe in the West and the countries of East Asia, provide a strategic central location to India. Note that the Deccan Peninsula protrudes into the Indian Ocean, thus helping India to establish close contact with West Asia, Africa and Europe from the western coast, and with Southeast and East Asia from the eastern coast. No other country has a long coastline on the Indian Ocean as India has, and indeed it is India's eminent position in the Indian Ocean which justifies the naming of the ocean after it. I'll come to this section later. Let's read through the next paragraph. India's contacts with the world have continued through ages, but her relationships through the land routes are much older than her maritime contacts. Maritime, I've written the meaning here for you, bounded with the sea or near the sea. The various passes across the mountains in the north have provided passages to the ancient travelers, while the oceans restricted such interaction for a long time. These routes have contributed in exchange of ideas and commodities since ancient times. The ideas of the Upanishads and the Ramayana, the stories of Panchatantra and the Indian numerals and the decimal system thus could reach many parts of the world. The spices, muslin and other merchandise were taken from India to different countries. On the other hand, the influence of Greek sculpture and the architectural styles of dome and minarets from West Asia can be seen in different parts of our country. Now comes our next topic, that is India's neighbors. India occupies an important strategic position in South Asia. India has 29 states and 7 union territories. India shares its boundaries with Pakistan and Afghanistan in the northwest, China, Nepal and Bhutan in the north, and Myanmar and Bangladesh in the east. Our southern neighbors across the sea consist of two islands, namely Sri Lanka and Maldives. Now all these details are in this map. You can obviously sit and mark. You can see Andaman, you can see Lakshadweep, you can see Pakistan. So it becomes easier for you, and then hence it will be easy for you to locate from the exam point of view. Now, Sri Lanka is separated from India by a narrow channel of sea formed by Park Strait and the Gulf of Mannar, while Maldives Islands are situated to the south of the Lakshadweep Island. India has had strong geographical and historical links with her neighbors. Look at the physical map of Asia in your atlas. I have arranged one map, but you can also observe your atlas because it's important. And note how India stands apart from the rest of Asia. Okay, now this ends your chapter here. These are the exercises given. You can do it on your own, you can attempt it. Okay, and then we can discuss it later, and don't worry about the question part. Okay, so let's start with the first thing first. So I have this sheet here which says some important things, school bhavan and do you know. Okay, so let's see this. There is a very important thing given here in this do you know section. It says school bhavan is a portal providing map based learning to bring awareness among the students about the country's natural resources, environment and their role in sustainable development. It is an initiative of Bhuvan, NRSC, ISRO. So this is these are the two organization that I've brought to with the on NCERT syllabus. You can explore various maps of India related to the secondary state. So these are the sites, and when you want to do any kind of map learning related to your NCERT book, you can just go and log in and you can go through all the maps given related to all these topics. It's a very good site. You are a techno savvy generation, so you can do that. Now here comes another do you know which is very important. They are talking about the Suez Canal. You all know that it is a man-made canal, it is a waterway, and it is there in Egypt, and it has been made with an intention to reduce the distance. Okay, so where has it reduced the distance? It has reduced the it's reduced India's distance from Europe by around 7,000 kilometers. So I'll show you a map, and it connects two very important water bodies, that is the Mediterranean Sea and the Red Sea. Okay, so it is a man-made thing. Okay, and let's see if anything else I'm missing on. No, so these two things are very, very important. Okay, now let's say India as a subcontinent. Now first you need to understand that why India is called a subcontinent. Why do we say India is a subcontinent? Now you know that because of the drifting of India from the Gondwana land, it went and hit the Eurasian plate. So Indo-Eurasian plate, when they collided, the Himalayas were formed, and India became a part of the Asian continent. So it is a part of the Asian continent, but still it is known as a subcontinent. And you have to understand that why we called India as a subcontinent, because either a place should be geographically a single entity, either it should be politically, or either it should be culturally. Okay, now when we see India, so its geography is in such a manner that it divides. It is a part of the Asian continent, but it divides topography is such that it divides it from the rest of the Asia. Like if we observe India here, then what happens? We have Himalayas here, we have the Hindu Kush mountain range here, and when we see here, we have the Indian Ocean, we have all the water bodies. So somewhere we see that India itself is, you know, a part of Asian continent, magar it bahut alag ho jata hai because of this division that is formed naturally. Himalayas are all natural, oceans are natural, so it's got a very strategic position. Okay, now which we say it is an Indian subcontinent, so India alone is not called a subcontinent. There are other countries that together form this Indian subcontinent. Now when you see this map, you can obviously mark those countries. Like Pakistan is there, Nepal is there, Bhutan is there, Bangladesh is there, Maldives is there, Sri Lanka is there. So all these countries together along with India, they form the Indian subcontinent. Okay, and when we talk about SAARC, so what is SAARC? It is South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. So it's an intergovernment organization. Now this is done with the aim where all the South Asian countries together form this association, and they work for the economic growth of these countries, and their motto is to promote peace and friendship and trust. Okay, so this is important. This may not come in the exam, but you should know that these subcontinent countries or the South Asian countries, they have their own organization also called as SAARC. You can read more about it if you are interested. There's no harm in it. Okay, now let's see India and the world. Now when we see India and the world, I have a picture here for you. You can very well see that India is located somewhere in the center of West Asia and East Asia. Now if we put this into North, West, East and South, okay, so here it is very well given in your textbook that India is a southwards extension. Okay, and it goes and protrudes where? In the Indian Ocean. Now because Indian Ocean is here, what happens? Indian Ocean is here, then it gives trans-Indian routes to connect India with other countries, with Europe. Okay, when you see you have a western coast, so again the country is here in the western coast. When we see the eastern coast, again the countries in the eastern coast are connected here. Okay, and plus when I'll tell you about the Swiss Canal, again India's and Europe's distances also decrease. Otherwise people had to turn all the way from turn around from Africa and come and trade with India. Now India was always a hub from the Asian time, and it was a big hub for trading. You know how Britishers also had come to India for trading purpose only. So this whole thing, if you observe this picture here and you put your textbook here and you see and you match all the details, okay, here, like say for instance, there's the first line that Indian landmass has a central location between East and West Asia. So you see it's just in the center. Everything around is like this, okay? And the best part of India is that it is surrounded by water. Now if you see a country like Nepal, or if you see a country like Afghanistan, or if you see a country like Bhutan, now these countries are known as landlocked countries. Okay, they are not connected to any water body. Landlocked countries means they are surrounded by land or other countries. So they don't have any coastal region. So that way India is very lucky and very fortunate that we are a peninsula, and especially we have the Indian Ocean. Now here in the last line, they have written about Indian Ocean, that Indian Ocean is one ocean which got its name from India. Now that is true, because when people used to come and trade with India, so those who used to sail using this route, they named this ocean okay, so now so many sea vessels, people used to trade with India, and they used to travel through Indian Ocean. So Indian Ocean's name was, they named this ocean after India. So Indian Ocean basically got its name from India. That is how it justifies that. Okay, now if you see this another image that I have for you, this one, you see, this is Swiss Canal. Okay, it is in Egypt. So basically you only get this one question, what is the significance of Swiss Canal? So the answer is in "do you know" only, that you have to write that it reduced the distance around 7000 kilometers between India and Europe. Okay, so that is there, but you can also see that how I have marked it for you, that how it is lying between the Mediterranean Sea and Europe. So they say around 50 ships are into transit every day. So you can imagine how many ships they are passing through this canal. It's a waterway, man-made. Okay, now let's go to this part here. Now this says contacts with the world, and we'll just do an observation. Okay, now let's see in this paragraph. We all know that Vasco da Gama was the first one to find the route. Okay, and he traveled through the water, but there were some, obviously when they used to travel through the water, there were always a chance of being attacked by the pirates and being looted also, and the traveling was very taxing because it was a very long route. But what about traveling before the sea route was explored? So people used to travel through the mountains, through the passages. Okay, here it is written that the land routes are much more older than the maritime contacts. So when you talk about these ancient travelers, so what kind of routes were they taking in? Okay, what was about the routes? So see here, I've just taken a picture for you. So here it is already given, Indus Valley Civilization. So we are talking about the ancient time. Now you can see here there is a Hindu Kush mountain range, and Khyber Pass is a part of this. I've written some points for you here. Then we have the Himalayas. Okay, then we have Bolan Pass, that is also in Pakistan. Okay, then we also have a Durand line. The Durand line was actually being drawn by Henry Durand, and it is a borderline between India and Afghanistan. Now this area, the border that is there of Afghanistan, it is in Pakistan occupied Kashmir at the moment. But earlier this passage was used in the ancient time by Afghans to travel through the northwestern region. Okay, so these are a few names of the ancient asks that in case you get a question in the exam that given it names of any two ancient passes, you know, which travelers use, you can take any of it and you can put it in the exam. So there is no big deal about it. Okay. Now comes the textbook paragraph, the last paragraph that I'm going to take, and I've put some questions here for you. Now when you read this paragraph, you can bifurcate this paragraph into three important questions that can shoot up in the exam. So I put them up here and you can find the answers from this paragraph. So first one is, which ideas of India reached the world? So very clearly it is given here that the ideas of Upanishads and Ramayanas, the stories of Panchatantra, the Indian numerals and the decimal system thus could reach many parts of the world. Now we all know that very famous Aryabhatta had given us zero. We know the stories of Panchatantra. We know what are Upanishads. They are the sacred books. Okay. So these all ideas, they were spreading through India. Now second one is, which commodities were exported from India? Again it is given here. So you can use that to learn. The spices, muslin and other merchandise were taken from India to different countries. Okay. The third question can come, from which regions and styles India got influence in the ancient times? So we already had read when we were reading the textbook that it is, on the other hand, influence of Greek sculpture. We know we have a very rich heritage, whether we talk about Mughals, whether we talk about Greeks, whether we talk about other West Asian minarets or other architectural styles of dome or whatever. So from this paragraph you can write this. This generally comes into the one marker. Okay. Now let's go to India's neighbors. Let's see what is there next. Now we all know that what are the neighboring countries of India. Still I have just written here. You can see in this map also given in your textbook on page 5. So you can make a simple flow chart like this also for your reference. You, when you make your own notes, always make flow charts, mind maps, write your summarization of paragraph where your paragraph is like, I gave you these three questions in this paragraph, like this in your a little way. You can also keep highlighting the important points. So these all things really help during the exam. Okay. Now see, Pakistan and Afghanistan are in the west. So here you have Afghanistan and you have Pakistan. Then China, Nepal and Bhutan in the north. So you have your China, you have your Nepal and you have your Bhutan. So they are all in the north. Then you have Myanmar and Bangladesh in the east. So you have your Myanmar and Bangladesh in the east. Okay. And then you have two southern neighbors here. So you have Sri Lanka and Maldives. Okay. So like this you can always remember that what are the neighboring countries of India. Okay. So we discussed the questions. That gave you three questions that can shoot in the exam in the one markers. Then you have seen the Indian neighbors, the countries. You can refer to your textbook map also in the states that share their boundaries with these neighbors. So this is a map like this. Okay, I've just made it in different colors for you to understand. So you can see different kilometers are there, and I've taken different colors for it. So like this, if you have this one here, so Pakistan is sharing its boundary with these states. Then this is China. So China has three lines here, this. So you can see Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim. Then it is sharing with Jammu Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand. Okay, so like this. So you can also do in the same manner. When you are doing the marking, it becomes very, very easy for you to remember. Or the second method is in such a manner that you can simply make a flow chart for yourself. So suppose it is Pakistan, or you can see it from here also, it is Jammu Kashmir, it is Punjab, it is Rajasthan and it is Gujarat. Okay. Now you can make a mnemonic also if you want. Jaise ki there is a mnemonic, say, okay, it's a simple mnemonic. Dekho, Parag Jayega Pakistan. So P se kya hua? It's Punjab. For R is Rajasthan. G Gujarat. Jayega, so J Jammu and Kashmir. And what is the country that it is neighboring? Pakistan. So like this for all you can make. So I'll just go through it. Like China, you can see Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttarakhand, Sikkim, and Arunachal Pradesh are here. So you see it is in three parts. So this is Sikkim here, this is Arunachal Pradesh, and this is Jammu Kashmir, then this is Himachal Pradesh, this is Uttarakhand. In the same manner you have for other countries, if you see Bhutan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Nepal. So I'm keeping this for some seconds. You can refer to this mini flowchart. Bhutan is Sikkim, West Bengal, Assam, Arunachal Pradesh, Bangladesh is West Bengal, Meghalaya, Tripura, Mizoram, Assam. If you do it in such a manner also, it becomes easier for you. Okay, when you do the Bangladesh outline, automatically you come to know okay, these are the boundaries and these are the states that they're touching in. If not, then if you can do this, this is a remembering part, okay? Or I can, you can make it easy with such things. You can form your own mnemonics. Nepal is Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Sikkim, West Bengal, okay? So like this. So this is one thing. So it is important for you to know, because generally one markers come from this. They can ask you. I'll show you how they put up the question and one of the assignments that I've already prepared for you. Okay, so it will become easier for you to understand. Now comes this one here. So see. Okay, so here they have given Sri Lanka is separated from India by a narrow channel of sea formed by Park Strait and Gulf of Mannar, with Maldives Islands are situated to the south of the Lakshadweep. Okay, so this is a very simple, very clean map that I have brought for you. Now, this is Gulf of Kutch here, this is Gulf of Kambat. Okay, this is Park Strait, this is Gulf of Mannar that separates Sri Lanka from India. Okay, and you know this is the Bay of Bengal. So generally they may ask you in one marker that what is the meaning of Gulf. So it is almost surrounded by land, you can see, but where does its mouth open? So it's like land meets sea. So its mouth generally opens in a sea. Now strait, it is a naturally formed narrow, typically navigable waterway. Navigable waterway means people can navigate from one place to another, that connects two larger water bodies larger water bodies of water. Most commonly, it is a channel of water that lies between two land masses. So you can already see it's between Sri Lanka and India. Now, bay is a body of water which is partially surrounded by land with a wide mouth which opens into the ocean. So you can see this. When you see the figure and when you read the definition, it becomes even more easier for you to relate to it. Because you're seeing the picture, you're reading the definition, and then somehow you can associate and connect to it. When you see a visual, it, at least something you'll be able to write in the exam. So it's not going to go completely blank, okay? So that is why it is very important to see the picture. Now last thing, last, now I always give something extra in my lesson. So this is something very extra that is not going to come in the exam, but from the general knowledge point of view, you can keep it in your mind. Now these are some important people. So you can see John Radcliffe is there, Arthur MacMahon is there, Henry Durand is there, and Mr. Redolf is there. Okay, so the picture was not found from on the net. So they had drawn up these important lines, and their lines are named after them only. So you can see the Radcliffe line. So it forms the border between India, Pakistan, and the same line you will find, because you know that Bengal was earlier one, and then later on after the partition of West Bengal and East Bengal, how one went to India and one went to Pakistan. So this Redcliffe line is also a border line between West Bengal and East Bengal. Then you have the Redolf line, it forms a border line between India and Nepal. And then you have the MacMahon line that demarcates between China and India. And this is what I was talking about, the Durand lines between Afghanistan and India. So these are the borderline names, okay? And these are the people who have drawn them up. It is after their names only, okay? So this is not going to come in the exam. This is just extra for you. You should know about your country. When you're learning, so you should learn well. Nothing should go untouched. And then comes your last, but not the least. Last but not the least, just a little differentiation between Andaman and Nicobar Islands. If any question pops up from this, so you should know. So Andaman and Nicobar Islands, their location is Bay of Bengal. Lakshadweep is in the Arabian Sea. You know Lakshadweep is famous for its coral reef. Coral Island, they are known as Coral Islands. This is the area that it covers. It is 32 square kilometer. And what about Andaman Nicobar? This is the area, 8,249 kilometers. It consists of how many islands? Obviously, we know that these two islands are bigger than this. So it has 11 islands and this has around 1,570 islands. Now, these consist of small-scale industry, whereas this has a main cultivation of coconut. So what is the capital of Andaman Nicobar? Port Blair. And what are the administrative headquarters called in the Lakshadweep Island? Kavarati. And which is the active volcano? Barren Island and Nicobar. And which is the there is a very famous bird sanctuary located in the Pitti Island, but it is inhabited by the humans. So most of the human beings are there. So this is there in the second half of the video, and now let's go to the last part, that is the assignment that I'm going to give you. So we are just going to discuss some questions. Let me see my sheet. So I'm giving you an assignment to do. You can read through the questions along with me, and then you can find the answers, or you can write it in your own words. The first is, what is a subcontinent? Name the countries that constitute the Indian subcontinent. Second one says, name the states of India which have common borders with China. So I've told you already that it can come in the exam. They might ask you one state, they might ask you all the states. So that is very important for you to know. Name the states which have common border with Myanmar. See, which two island countries are of India are India's neighbors? So again, you have to answer, not me. Mention the types of states in India present before 1947. So this section comes, this question comes from this section, do you know? I always tell you that they generally give you questions from do you know. So in this it is written, before 1947 there were two types of states in India, the provinces and the princely states. Provinces were ruled directly by the British officials who were appointed by the Viceroy. Princely states were ruled by the local hereditary rulers who acknowledged sovereignty in return for local autonomy. So here you have to give the same answer, that the two types of states were princely and provincial. Okay, then who ruled the princely states? So it's given here, who were the ones? They were the local hereditary rulers. Okay, so you can find this answer here. Now name the country that has common land frontier with states of Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh. So now this time it is, the tables have turned around. This time they have given you the states, they are asking you the country. So you have to find the name of it. Name the states of India which lie along the eastern coast of India from north to south. Which route connects countries of Europe in the west to the countries of East Asia? Okay, so here is the answer I'm giving you. It's given in your India neighbors. So Trans-Indian Ocean Routes. Okay, so you underline this also in your textbook. Now, what is the significance of Swiss Canal? I've already discussed this question when we were doing the Swiss Canal part. How has India kept a relationship with the world in ancient times? Now, these all three questions I've done from the textbook paragraph on page number 4. From which regions and styles India got influence? Again, the Greek agriculture, architectural and dome, that is one. Okay, that is what you did. So with this, we come with the end of the chapter. I hope you may not have any query, but if you have, you're more than welcome. You can always put it up. If there is any part, any particular part that you need help with, please do get back to me on this. Okay, but read your textbook, underline your things. Make notes of each paragraph. You can go walk an extra mile. If I've told you about SAARC, you can read more about SAARC. What kind of an association is it? Okay, so there is no blockage that, oh, if it is given only this much in the textbook, we need to stick to this much only. Okay, you can always walk an extra mile. So bye for now. Take care. Do well in your papers.